In this video of our Math 2 MVP curriculum, we are looking in Unit 6, Lesson 2, Times Running Out. In the previous lesson, we looked at Family Kingdom Amusement Park in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, and how they needed to be prepared for the chance of a tsunami. We learned in that lesson how to determine how fast the wave was moving, but the big question is, how can we use this information to help them prepare? So if you remember from back in the day in science, you learned that the rate of speed for something is the distance divided by the time. So what we know is that the earthquake was detected at 22 degrees, 27 minutes, and 6 inches, or 27 degrees, 27 minutes, 6 seconds north, and 54 degrees, 2 minutes, and 47 seconds south, or west, which was 27,393.82 kilometers from Family Kingdom Amusement Park. This means we can model the time versus the rate with the equation. Our equation is R equals 27,393.82 divided by T. So this particular type of function is known as an inverse function. One way that we can recognize this as inverse is thinking about the operations. When we're solving equations and we have x plus 5 equals 10, we use the additive inverse of 5, which is negative 5, to solve. So we use the opposite sign, the opposite operation. So when I think about most functions, most of the functions that we have studied up to this point have involved some form of multiplication of x or multiplication of our variable. In this particular situation, we're now looking at division of our variable. So that's kind of my memory tool for remembering that this is an inverse function. Now, then I've already created our graph and our table here. The big thing to recognize in this particular situation is that, again, we have an undefined section. This undefined section is occurring where x is 0. So if we look at our graph is never actually touching that y-axis. That is because I cannot divide by 0. So nothing is going to be created there. In addition, my y is never going to be 0. That is because if I were to plug in 0 for y and try to solve this problem over t, if I multiply by t, then I have 0 equals a number, and that's not a true statement. So this is also not there. These two lines, in this case, are called asymptotes. And an asymptote is a line on a graph that cannot be crossed by your function. So I often think about these as boundaries. Our function, our graph, is going to get as close to that asymptote as it possibly can, but it's never actually going to touch or cross that asymptote. All right, so the first thing that we want to do with this information is we want to identify our domain and range, just like in lesson one. So our domain here, if we're looking at our x's, I can go negative infinity on my x values. I'm going to keep going as far as I can until I get close to 0 on my x value, or close to 0 on my y's. However, when I get close to 0 on my x values, I stop. And I end up jumping, so we use the U for the and I actually need to fix something. We should have a parenthesis at 0, because we can't actually ever touch 0. And then once we jump over 0, essentially, our graph is going to get as close to it as it can, and then it's going to keep going towards infinity. The range is very similar. The range is going to go down forever. It's going to go down as far as it can. But when it gets up to that x-axis, it's going to stop. And then it's going to jump and go to where it's going towards infinity. So we have a break in the graph that we have to represent with that U, that and notation. So number four is asking us to describe the rate of change, and how does the rate of change compare? All right, so in an inverse function, if you notice, and we have to think about how we travel along a graph, and we travel from the left. So as we travel along this graph from the left, notice that we are decreasing. And even after we jump, and we start as close to zero as we can get, we're still decreasing. Our y values are still getting smaller and smaller. But the graph is decreasing in two different ways in this particular case. So in the upper first quadrant, when our graph is up here, our graph is decreasing. At a decreasing rate. Because if you notice, as it gets closer and closer to the x-axis, it gets flatter and flatter. Now, the other piece of it, the piece in our third quadrant, it is decreasing. An increasing rate. This is because as it's continuing along, it is getting faster and faster as it tries to get to negative infinity. In the model, the distance was 27,393.82, which is measured in kilometers. What are logical units for t and for r? So if we think about this, rr is our rate, equals our kilometers over our time. So we know our rate has to be kilometers per something. So if we think about what our time is, if our time was in seconds, kilometers per second. So that's saying that our speed is 27,000, let's just round it for a minute, kilometers per second. That is ridiculously fast and does not make logical sense. So the next thing to go to would be another unit of time of hours. Okay, it's gonna go 27,000 kilometers in 1 hour. Also very fast. So now let's think about the next unit of time above an hour is days. So 27,000 kilometers in a day. Okay, so let's think about this in some units that we think more about a little bit. So one thing that we think about regularly in our life is miles versus kilometers. That is how our speed is read in our vehicles. And so if I'm thinking about this amount, this 27,000, I'm just going to keep it rounded, kilometers, that is approximately 16,800 miles approximately. So thinking about that in the terms of a day, if I were to divide a day into 24 hours, 16,800 divided by 24 hours is about 699 miles per hour. Now that is very fast, but that is a realistic unit of time. So what we can think about here is that it's kilometers per day, because breaking that down into some units that make a little bit more sense to us in terms of how we talk about measurements in America can help us kind of think back to how we might could represent it in kilometers. All right, our last question in this lesson is question six that we're going to look at. And it says, in the Watch Out for That Wave lesson task, we determined that the wave was traveling towards Family Kingdom Amusement Park at 224.66 meters per second. Determine how long it'll take the wave to reach Family Kingdom Amusement Park. So here we know our speed, 224.66 meters per second. And we know that our function is rate equals 20 27,393.82. I'm going to double check those numbers real fast. 27,393.82. Yep. Divided by time. Okay. Now, it does say note that the units for the wave speed involve meters, not kilometers. So we do need to use that in our thinking. In order to solve this problem, we're going to have to convert one of our numbers to the other unit. So either we need to create our speed in kilometers per second, or we need to take our kilometers and convert them into meters. So if you think about this, the relationship between 1 kilometer as compared to meters is that 1 kilometer is 1,000 meters. So probably the easiest thing to do is going to be to take our, the fact that we already know we have 27,393.82 kilometers and multiply that by 1,000, which is going to give us 27,393.820. So reading that number is 27,393,820 meters. So now we have a rate of 224.66 equal to 27,393,820 divided by our time. To solve this, we're going to multiply by time, which would give us 224.66 t equals the 27,393,820. Then we will divide by the 224.66. Now when you do this, you're going to get a time of 121,934.6 seconds. Now, obviously, that is a ridiculous number to think about, so let's do some conversions. If I want to convert that number to minutes, 121,934.6 seconds, if I'm converting that to minutes, I'm going to divide that by 60, because there are 60 seconds in 1 minute. So that would give us 2,032.2 minutes, still a large number. I'm going to divide that by 60 again to get an hour. In an hour, this is 33.9 hours. If you want to go further and think about it in terms of a day, I'm going to divide by 24. And that would be 1.4 days. So what this is telling us is that Family Kingdom basically has a day, almost a day and a half before that tsunami reaches them, that they have to prepare. Or if you want to look at it in terms of hours, they have about 34 hours before that tsunami reaches them to make preparations. That concludes lesson 2, where we looked at inverse variation functions.